about.
Thank you.
And welcome to Community United Church, for those of you in the sanctuary, for all those of you who are live with us online, and for those of you who will join us in a few hours, a few days, or a few weeks, all are welcome here. The altar flowers this morning are given to the glory of God and in loving memory of Teresa from her sister Carol. So Carol, thank you much for that memorial for your sister, and we hold her in prayer with you. Just a few announcements before we begin worship this morning. If you'll take out your bulletin, or if you're online, if you'll click on the electronic bulletin for you on the back, and there's a few things already listed for you. I'd like to add to those. Excuse me. So prayer requests, if you have those, trying to make this a habit, if you have prayer requests in the sanctuary, there's little pieces of paper. We just need those by the gospel reading. Same if you're online right now. You can put that in the chat window, and our tech team will bring that to us. I want to thank the tech team and all their special help. They've been here hours and hours and hours this week fixing. We had some audio trouble in the last few weeks. Turns out it was nothing to do with any human person. It was drivers that were broken in the machine itself that needed to be uploaded and fixed. So thank you, tech team, for all of your work and all the people who came in this week. It helps us to stay connected, especially for those of you who are home right now, and I know have had a little bit of trouble hearing for the last couple of weeks. There is no Resonate coming up this Wednesday. There'll be a bit of a break just for the holiday. People will be, I think, recovering for that or just need a little bit of time off. And then on the third Wednesday of July, the Reverend Dr. Matty Rendulik, who started our Resonate service, will be back to lead us in another one. And he sent me the advanced copy of it, and it looks really good. It's jam-packed with music of singing and prayers and of his own performances as well. Next, a call for help here. Next Saturday on July 10th, we're hoping to get a number of people to come into the church to help. I call it beautifying the building. It's already a beautiful facility. But our new website company is going to be coming in on July 11th, the next day, in order to take pictures of us in our space, right? So that means that during the worship service, they're not going to be coming up to your faces, but they'll be in the back and taking pictures so that on our new website, you can actually see the church as we're functioning, the different rooms. So if visitors want to know what can they expect when they come in. So, you know, if you look closely, just like at our own houses, every once in a while you look around and go, oh yeah, there's paint missing from the wall, right? You know, or things that we need to do. So next Saturday on July 10th, we will meet here. If you would like to volunteer, and if you know you can't, you can't. We understand that. But if you'd like to volunteer, meet here at 11 a.m. Next Saturday morning, and we'll begin a process, just kind of spot checking things around, cleaning up what we can, and then after we're done with that, a few of us will stage the church so that it looks really nice for the pictures. This is also a call not only for all of us in the sanctuary today, but if you are at home, a call to say if you're in the Erie area, and you can be physically present next week. It'll be great to be able to show, you know, that the people who are here with our congregation. I was sharing at council this last Monday. You know, if you only come like once a month or once every 6 weeks, which is totally fine, we don't keep attendance, you might think, oh, there's only about 40 or 50 people in this church. That is not true. Our congregation of members and friends is actually somewhere around 150, 175. And so when you meet people who are coming in, I know a lot of people are still at home from the pandemic. We have a whole camping group, a whole group from Florida. I welcome back Hyatts. It's good to see you back there, right? So the church is much bigger than what you think that it is. And sometimes we just need a good reason to all come together, and it can't just be Christmas and Easter. So if you can, be here next Sunday so that we get a good sense of who's in the church for the website itself. Of course, this week we also saw the very, very sad news, local news, that a tragic double homicide and then suicide. And Alyssa Davis actually went to school with one of the children that were killed, and with the Zimmer family. So this morning, without getting into those details or to assign blame, but only to embrace pain, let us light our red candle this morning in memorial of the suffering in the world that we know always takes place. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, you made us in love, and you made us, because we're in love, to be free with our choices. Choices that are complicated by our own pain, our own hurting, feelings of brokenness, despair. And so we lift up this morning, God, the Zimmer family, knowing that you alone, by the presence of your love and wisdom, can comfort and guide. and for the whole community, for the school, for all those who are hurting, for all those who are asking why. We ask, God, that you would somehow be present in their lives as well. And for those of us who walk in the way of Christ, help us to remember that his very life story is not always one of mountaintop transfigurations where everything is okay. But you, Jesus, went into the heart of human pain. You yourself experienced it in your own flesh, in your own death. Though we don't always understand and we ask why, help us to know that in you, precious Savior, we have someone who has walked every step of tragedy with us so that we might hope for new life to come. God, we believe that your loving power and presence refines all, and that when we draw this last breath from this life, you welcome us into another. May that be our vision for the Zimmer family, and may we leave all love and justice to you. We pray this in the name of Jesus, and all of God's people said, Amen. In that sense and in that spirit, we are in the last of 3 weeks from our first teaching series on eschatology, or the study of the end. And this week, we're taking a look at how it is that most visions of the end that we see in the Bible aren't actually about, as we know, about predicting anything or timelines. They're actually about getting us to live on earth as it is in heaven, which Jesus actually teaches us to pray. So I invite you this morning to begin to tune your heart into a time of worship, to open your mind and your hearts and your spirits to what wisdom we'll find together in the scriptures, so that we can come before a God and worship now, a God who loves us always and in always. Let us center our hearts for worship. In the invocation as printed in your bulletin or online for you at home. Grace, mercy, and peace be with you from God, our Creator, Christ, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit, our eternal advocate and friend. Holy and loving God, we gather in the name of Christ, who teaches us to pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In that prayer, O God, you move us to live on earth as it is in heaven. Spirit of God, you grant us glimpses of heaven so that we might know how to live on earth. You show us the coming renewal of all things so that we might work towards renewal now. You show us the end of pain and suffering so that we might learn how to promote justice and flourishing. Christ Jesus, you reveal to us in your life, death, and resurrection a great truth. Only that which is good will endure in the life of the world to come. So let us commit ourselves to the ways of love and restorative justice, believing that as we do, the people of the earth will know that you reign in us and that your promises are true. Amen. And now, as you are able, please rise in spirit or body as we sing our opening hymn, Alleluia, Alleluia, Hearts to Heaven, verses 1, 2, and 3. Thank you. Holy and loving God, we do come to you this morning in the name of Jesus and by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. Christ, we follow after you into your life, knowing that we can and do meet you on the mountaintops where there are miracles and transformations, and we can and do meet you in life's suffering and pain so that you might be all in all, and that one day you will even put death under your feet. So God, in this hour of worship that we have together, set our vision on that greater good. Remind us again that we are a pilgrim people on a journey towards reunification and restoration of all things. And while we live and move and have our being in time and space, help us to be ambassadors of Christ, always, always advocating peace, striving for wisdom, and being ever more inclusive of all your people. May the vision of that heavenly worship of all the angels and saints and all who have gone before us so move us even now that we experience those feelings, that joy, that glory of heavenly worship. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, and all of God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
If you're standing, you may be seated. Let us join together now in the Litany for Our Nation, recognizing for those of us who are U.S. citizens or who live here, this is the weekend that we commemorate independence. But there's something special and unique that we have to do in church, because nation is not the kingdom of God or the reign of God. Those are two different things, and it's our faith that should inform the other. So join me together as we read this Litany for Our Nation as a prayer. People of God, as members of the body of Christ, our primary identity belongs to the reign of God on earth as it is in heaven. And as a people who live in space and time, we are born in particular places, belong to various communities, and find ourselves part of a nation's history and story. As members and friends of Community United Church, many of us find ourselves participating in the history and story of the United States of America. On this weekend that we commemorate our human story of independence from civil monarchy, we seek to celebrate what is good of our nation, even as we hear the divine call to mend our every flaw. If, O God, our cause of liberty is right, and our arc towards justice is true, be with us in our virtue, and let the fire of your conviction burn within us to overcome every remaining injustice in our land. And so let us declare in this time of worship that we will be citizens of heaven first, always ambassadors of peace, and ever oriented toward justice, and all until we see the fruits of heaven growing upon this land we call home. Amen. In our national hymns, we do sing about mend our every flaw. For as much as we praise the goodness of what we hope we've achieved so far, we know that that vision of a more perfect union is still not here yet. And Christians dare not confuse faith with politics. But in this time, we can do good in the streets. We can do good in our halls of government if we allow justice to guide us. Of all the many things that we know still need fixing, let us sing this song, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. peace as our faith statement of who we will seek to be when we're in the civic sphere.
Our first reading this morning is Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 3, verses 10 through 15. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, the work of each builder will become visible, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each has done. If what has been built on the foundation survives, the builder will receive a reward. If the work is burned up, the builder will suffer loss. The builder will be saved, but only as through fire. Our song of reflection is Refiner's Fire.
Set up apart for you, my master, ready to do your will. Purify my heart, cleanse me from within, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will.
And our second reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." Our responsorial is taken from Psalm 22 and is in your bulletin. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who revere the Holy One. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek God shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before the Holy One. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and God rules over the nations. To God, indeed, shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before God shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for the Lord.
Posterity will serve the Holy One. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people not yet born, saying that God has done it. Amen.
Please stand as you're able for our Gloria, then remain standing for our gospel.
Glory be to God. Now and so shall be.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 31 through 46. Listen again for the living word and wisdom of God who is still speaking and who we find understanding from as we listen more carefully. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations shall be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger or naked or sick in prison, and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. These are the words of God for the people of God. Come, Holy Spirit, thanks be to God. If you're standing, you may be seated, please. So one of the most common questions that I get from adults that are studying Christianity, whether here at the church or at the university where I teach, is this question. Why didn't they teach me this in Sunday school? And the "this" that they're referencing are a lot of things, like learning about when the scriptures were written, by whom, and in what context. Or learning about how different books of the Bible came together from across the millennia in different languages that have a wide range of meaning that aren't always obvious just in our native tongue. Or learning that there are some stories in the Bible that originally were not meant to be taken literally, but are more like deep parables trying to get us to believe a really important truth, not science and history like we understand it today. And that you have to always be thinking about these things as you turn from page to page to page in the Bible. So one of the things that I'd like to do someday is actually write a little pamphlet maybe and put it in my classroom in the church and say, all right, if I could leave you with three pieces of advice even when I'm gone about the Bible, here would be these three pieces of advice. Take them or leave them. Number one, the Bible is not actually a book. It's a bookshelf. And maybe even better, it's a quilt. Each text has its own angle. Each text has its contextual fabric and its own original audiences. And all of that is really, really, really important to slow down and study. None of us know these things. We have to dig deep to find out what they are. After all, think of a quilt, right? The piece of jeans on the quilt is very different from the piece of cloth from your baptismal dress. Very, very, very different, telling different stories. Which leads me to my second piece of advice about the Bible. Pay close attention, assume nothing. It is easy to read over or fill in or assume what a text means on the basis of what others have said it means. One of the things that I realized, even about myself, and I think about all people of faith when it comes to the Bible, especially in Christianity, is if we're not careful, we won't notice. We stand on the shoulders of other theologians who've already taught us how to look at the Bible, but then we think, I'm looking at it with fresh eyes. Instead of saying, now wait a second, am I just reading it the way that I've been told to read it? a Bible study I did a couple years ago with a good friend of mine who's an evangelical Calvinist, right? So we have some debates between one another, but good friend of mine. I went to he and his wife's Bible study, and I said, all right, if we're going to do this Bible study, we can't do it from John Calvin's perspective, and the guy's got some interesting insights, and we can't just do it from a secular perspective. Let's try to read the Bible as if for the first time and ask what we discover there, instead of standing on the shoulders of other theologians who are basically giving us a tinted glasses of how to read the text before us. Read it as if it's for the first time. Make no assumptions. And that leads me to my third piece of advice about the Bible. Everyone, 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 including me right now, has to make interpretive choices about the Scripture. Interpretive choices about the Scripture. About what a particular Scripture means. And then after you study a particular Scripture, how that Scripture is in relationship to other Scriptures, of other books, of different canons. And that means that as we're interpreting the Scriptures, we can be more or less right or wrong about things, because words do have meanings and context is important. And if we don't have that, we're going to miss a lot, including me. But one thing is guaranteed. No matter how much more or less we might be right or wrong about how we interpret Scripture, how we interpret Scripture says everything about us and what we choose. Yes, are we trying to be faithful and reasonable interpretation? Yes. But how we interpret says something about us. For example, if I were to prioritize texts of judgment in this eschatology series we're doing, if I were to prioritize texts of judgment over texts of love, you should be asking the question, what does that say about me? Right or wrong, what does that say about me? Or take it out of the Bible for a second, just into faith itself. If I were to say something like this, my anger is always righteous, and everybody out there needs to be corrected or they're demon-possessed, is suggesting God is not only on my side, I have the mind of God, and it's everybody else out there that needs shaping up. Dangerous, right? Now, I share all this with you because we've come now to our final of just 3 weeks of looking at Christian Scripture and interpretations of Scripture in this teaching series on that big fancy word, eschatology, right? The study of the end. And for the last 3 weeks, or last two Sundays, we've seen a couple of things. We've seen how, yes, probably well-intentioned people have claimed to have special knowledge about the end of the world, claiming they have special insight into the Bible, or you hear sometimes hear people talking about decoding Bible prophecies, when in fact, what did we learn 2 weeks ago? The Scriptures tell us, both plainly and contextually, no one knows the day or the hour. And Christianity as a religion has 2,000 years of people trying to do that and always, always, always being wrong. Always. No one knows the day or the hour. We've also seen, again, how well-intended people have tried to create a plot line for the end of the world with doctrines about raptures and great tribulations, only for us to find that both contextually and plainly in the Scriptures, no such plot line exists. Last week, I shared with you there's whole movie series, right? 4130 movies from the 1970s and on. I watched four of those back-to-back this week just to make sure that I was right about that. I'm not sure that that was worth my time, but I did it, right? And all of them were like, see, we can point to this, 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 and this. It's a plot line. You're going to get raptured. People are going to get left behind. When in fact, the Scriptures that are used to make that interpretation aren't about that at all. Their visions of reunification, of a glorious day when those who have departed us will join back together with us and Christ. So today we spend just one last Sunday looking at even more scriptural references to the end. And when we do that, and we're not in lectionary anymore right now, we're choosing the Scriptures we're taking a look at, but if we look back at the Scriptures that we have assigned for today, notice that almost every single reading here, and keep reading the New Testament, almost every single reading about, quote, the end of the world is almost more about how are we living on earth. and not in the sense with narrow agendas of like trying to get people to believe like us in narrow, rigid ways. No, like living on earth as it is in heaven, making a better earth now by visions of the end. Consider, if you will, turn with me to our first reading today from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. There, Paul says, a day is coming where the work of each builder, that's you and I, the things that we have created on earth, will be disclosed before God. Now, it is true. The language here is very eschatological. It's oriented toward a final day. Paul is talking about, in the Jewish language, they would call it the day of visitation. In the Christian theological language, we say it more like judgment day, where God comes for a final accounting, a final reckoning before life begins anew in the world to come. That is the day that Paul is referring to there. And there is no question that some, unfortunately, Christians and churches have used this scripture and Paul's description of a coming judgment day and the disclosing of our deeds, notice the language in the text itself, to scare people into certain prescribed forms of belief narrowly or prescribed forms of behavior. It goes something like this. I remember this from high school and early days of college when I would go to like the Bible studies in the school in the morning. Literally was told, we opened up to this passage, and it said, well, this is what's going to happen to you, Rich, the whole room, on Judgment Day. You're going to be in a long line, and you're going to get up to the throne room, and on the throne room, there's going to be this big screen that everybody is going to be able to see, and they're going to see everything that you've ever done. Yikes. How many of you have heard that before? Judgment Day. There's going to be a big screen, and everything you've ever done is disclosed. But friends, sorry to say it this way, but this is the creepy Santa Claus version of God, right? Who sees you when you're sleeping, who knows when you're awake, who knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. I don't think we do ourselves very well by teaching our children or ourselves that God is some kind of weird voyeur who's keeping a list of everything wrong that you've done so that God can shame you on Judgment Day. How is that good news? How is that love? If you ask me, and I'm not a therapist, that sounds like abuse. Threatening to disclose your worst mistakes to embarrass us, you better be a good little girl. You better be a good little boy. You know what I'm saying? That type of attitude and interpretation has been used of this text. I call it the creepy Santa Claus version of God, and I don't think it's right. But that is not actually what Paul just wrote. Remember advice number two? Assume nothing, read carefully. Look at the text again. Paul said, yeah, a day is coming when all will be disclosed before God, to God. And then look even more closely. Paul says that each one of us are kind of like builders. In the course of our lives, we're constantly building things. And Paul says in this really kind of mystical, cosmic vision of Christ, he says, you know, we don't build our own foundation. Jesus Christ is the foundation, the one in whom we live and move and have our being. That is the security of all things are in Christ. We live and move and have our being in that. And as we do, we have some relative freedom to choose what we're going to build. And so as builders, the day will come where our works to God, not to embarrass people, will come before God. And Paul writes this, the work of each builder will become visible and it will be revealed with fire. Keep reading. The fire of that day will test what sort of work each has done. If what has been built upon the foundation, Christ, survives, then the builder is rewarded for it. But if the work is burnt up, the builder will suffer loss, but, what's the last line? The builder will be saved. That is scriptural. That it is only in Christ, which is why we talk about we're saved by grace and not by works, right? That we are saved by grace. We access that by faith. That's the good news. We can start living into that. And that when it comes to what we do, there's some good things in our lives and some bad things, but Paul, the Apostle Paul, is saying on the day of judgment, only goodness can go through with us into eternity, and all that isn't good will be left behind. But in that sense of almost like when a jeweler has to take gold and purify the gold and get the impurities out so that the jeweler can create the beautiful, fashionable jewelry, in this case, which is you. You are saved because of grace. What we build, Paul is saying, is going to be revealed, disclosed, refined, why we just sang refiner's fire, refined with a fire that doesn't seek to destroy us, it seeks to renew us. And that not only is good news, that's reassuring news. We're not going to be put in a public spotlight to be shamed on Judgment Day. We are going to come into the fire that is God's love and be refined so that the best and the brightest version of us, what God intended, comes through into eternity forever. Which is why I believe we can say, when we say the Apostles' Creed every few weeks or so, that we believe in the day of judgment, when Christ comes to judge the living and the dead. We say that with hope because it's good news, because the judgment is refining. It isn't paying you back or wanting to shame you. It also means this, if Paul's analogy is right here, and I believe that it is, if we are building on Christ, on the grace that we've been given to hold us in security forever, then we have a choice about what we build on earth. We have choices to build things that can endure with us into heaven, to live on earth as it is in heaven. And I think this is what our gospel reading is really trying to drive home for us today. What is it that we build in our life? If you turn with me to our gospel reading there, Jesus provides us with a glimpse, some scholars say a parable about the day of judgment, from the turning of this age to the eternal age to come. Now, in this story, he shocks a lot of people in his original audience. I dare think he shocks some people today with this teaching that Jesus has. Instead of telling people, so he's saying, all right, a day of judgment's coming, he's there too. Instead of saying, all right, there's going to be a catechism test, right, in heaven, and we're going to see what you've memorized or what you've happened, or we're going to check your denominational membership and see if you were the right one or the wrong one. Notice it's not there. Notice there is no test of how pious were you or how righteous were you in the sense of kind of ritual righteousness. Instead, what does Jesus say? Those who go into eternal paradise are the ones who exercise basic human kindness. You fed the hungry, you gave the thirsty something to drink, you welcomed the stranger, you clothed the naked, you visited the sick and imprisoned, and so forth. Those in his story about who don't go there, who go into the eternal fire, are those who don't exercise even basic human kindness. Now, there are some people who right now are going to say, aha, Jesus finally said it, Pastor Rich, eternal fire, right? And that's where some people are going. Yes, Jesus did say these things in this passage. Now ask the important questions. Why? With what purpose? In the Jewish tradition, there is something called the prophetic exaggeration. The great contemporary rabbi, Abraham Heschel, scholar, talks about this. The prophetic exaggeration. The prophetic exaggeration in Judaism always starts with the announcement of big, bad judgment, right? Wrath, and everything is going to be destroyed. And only after the audience is paying attention does it actually get to its point. The prophetic exaggeration starts with big bad wrath and then finally gets to its point. Don't believe me? Go read the Jewish Bible in the book of the prophet Zephaniah. There in that book, it starts with this declaration. God's really mad and God's going to destroy everything, even creatures that God's not mad at. Two chapters later, it says, when God's wrath is poured out, it will purify the speech of the people. The prophetic exaggeration, I want to be careful with this, but the prophetic exaggeration reminds me like when my sisters and I were on a long car trip with my parents, and we started misbehaving in the back seat of the car, and one of the parents turned around and says, do we need to pull this vehicle over right now, right? That type of thing. Or in school, if you were misbehaving, you need to go down to the principal's office. It feels like the end of the world. Good discipline, though, always leads to something better, something constructive. The prophetic exaggeration starts with wrath and then moves to the point. And this is precisely what Jesus is doing in this passage. Think about it. Did Jesus say here in this passage, I'm telling you what's going to happen. There are some people destined for hell forever. No. He's telling a story to grab hold of the reader, the audience then and now, to say, if I was standing before Jesus and Jesus gave me this story, what would it do to me? What should it be doing to us right now? A review of my life and asking, what am I building? Have I turned my Christianity only into I can side off this theology and I can study that deeply, but I haven't fed my neighbor? Do I go around saying I'm saved by grace, but there's no evidence in my life that that grace has transformed me? Jesus is using the prophetic exaggeration here to get those who are following in his name to act like it. I don't think he's saying that you've got to work your way to heaven. He is saying to people who are following after him, if we dare to claim the grace and the love of God in his name, then let's have some evidence for that in our life. And as I said last week, if you need a little fire underneath you, right, to get there, Jesus has plenty of that for you. But the fire is what? Redemptive. Which makes me wonder in this passage, if you take Paul and Jesus and put them together, Jesus talks about that fire into which the devil and his angels go. It kind of makes me wonder if that just means that the devil and the angels have nothing good left to redeem. Because the fire is supposed to redeem you, not to punish you forever and ever. And that is our opportunity and has been the opportunity for every generation of Christians for the last 2,000 years. To embrace our vision of Judgment Day as refining. To embrace the vision of heaven as something that moves us to live on earth as it is in heaven, knowing that we are saved by grace and have an opportunity here to make a difference in people's lives. How many times do we hear people saying, "Where is God in the world?" And Christ's answer to that has always been, you now are the body of Christ. Feed the hungry. Give the thirsty something to drink. Love the stranger. Why has the church struggled with that one? Open the doors. Heal the sick. However we can. Visit those who are incarcerated, institutionalized, without judgment. And when we do that, heaven comes to earth. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, move in our hearts right now with conviction so that we might be a people who will commit ourselves again to that vision of the life to come so that we can live it now. Move in us, yes, with that refining fire, but also with grace. Soften our theology if we use it to hurt others. Move us away from things that don't show your love. And help us to continue to build a church where all are welcome so that all can have that foretaste of heaven. So that in this place and in these times, people will know that you are in our hearts and that you are alive. We pray this in your name, O Jesus, and all of God's people said, Amen. Let us sing our song of response as a prayer of commitment. Come, all Christians, be committed. people of God, let us join now around the communion table where we find the same message of grace, hope, and love. Please join me in the communion liturgy. People of God, the table before us is set by heavenly hands. Come to the table and let us remember the Last Supper of Christ and the death he faced. Come to the table and find a living mystery. Here the Holy Spirit makes the resurrected and ascended Christ truly present in bread and cup. Come to the table and find an open doorway to heaven, which shows us a foretaste of the eternal feast, which we will share with all who have gone before us into glory. This is a table of grace. There is room around it for every soul that was and is and is to come. At this table, all who are far off are made very near. We come to the table as people who are learning the way of Christ. We confess that we are not always right, but we share this faith, that those who trust in Christ Jesus will grow in the assurance of God's eternal love. And so here at this table, we take the bread and we take the cup, and we ask now, Holy Spirit, to make it for us communion with Christ, who gave his life as the bread of heaven and as the cup of eternal life. Here at this table, we remember that Christ gave his entire life as an outpouring of God's love, a love that will one day renew all things. Amen. Friends, this is the body of Christ. Friends, this is the communion of the blood of Christ. Gather around this table, all of us with different needs. Some of you are hungry not just for food, that too. Some of you are hungry for something missing in your life. Keep coming back to the table. All of us have endured through a pandemic, still having to use our noisy cups in the pews. The table gives us a foretaste of a feast at which there will be no more death, no more suffering, where we will be filled forever. I invite us to keep coming around the table now in a spirit of worship and prayer as we sing together, You Satisfy the Hungry Heart, and pour out to God in the quiet of your heart, what do you need to be filled right now? Where are you hungry? Where are you thirsty? Because even as the Lord says, how we feed others, we feed him. Our Lord is also the one who wants to come to us and nourish and feed us. Pour out your hearts, cry out to God, and find a God who meets you where you are.
yourself to us, O Lord. Then selfless let us be to serve each other in your name, in truth and charity. You satisfy the hungry heart with gifts of finest wheat. Come
be with you. Let us pray for the prayer requested have come to us today, whether they are joys or sorrows. And we do have a praise for Bethany and Jamie for the birth of Julian, who was born with some challenges. They are all doing well and now at home, and we praise God for that. Let us pray for Carol's friend who's grandson died in a car accident this week, and we ask for all love and grace and healing to be with that family. We pray for Andy having knee surgery this week, and we pray for his pain to be relieved. We pray for answers for health concerns for Karen. We pray for strength for Yvette Miller. We pray for Lisa, who's lost four people close to her in the last 18 months. We pray for healing. And we pray for those suffering anxiety, depression, loneliness, and confusion. And we pray for those unspoken prayers as well as those spoken. Holy and loving God, in your wisdom, meet all of these needs in your perfect way of grace. God, hear our prayer that we would be a people who talk about heaven, but demonstrate it with our lives and all works of justice and charity. God, hear our prayer that the leaders of all faith communities, nations, schools, care facilities, and service agencies would find themselves wholly oriented toward the care of all, especially the least among us. God, hear our prayer for all that we hold in the silence of our hearts. We come to you in the confidence of quiet, O God, and lift now our petitions privately to you. Almighty God, sovereign of heaven, send a double portion of your blessings upon all people. Move these mountains in our lives, or help to move us so that we might be fully at peace. And this we do pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends of God, before our service comes to an end, we have just a little bit more time to respond to God's wisdom and God's grace. And we invite you to use this time of offertory in three ways. The most important is a time of prayer and contemplation for you to think about how you will be an offering to the world, heaven on earth, coming this week. That is the most important part of offertory. If you would like to give a material gift to the church, you can do that. We promise it's received well, either by, if you're in the sanctuary at the end of the service, we have a tray out for you there. If you're online, we have a link for that. But our most important thing to do is to bind together as a community and pray now, how shall we now live on earth as it is in heaven?
Thank you.
Please rise.
Prayers printed in your bulletin. Holy and loving God, Alpha and Omega of all that was and is and evermore shall be, remind us of your presence in our lives and empower us to be citizens of heaven on earth.
Infuse us within faith, hope, and love so that we might be a people who reflect your grace, strength, and mercy. Send us out with assurance that you are with us always. Even until the very end of time itself.
Amen. Our closing hymn is "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory."
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed a faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of the 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall ever call retreat. He is lifting out the hearts of all before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer God. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make us holy, let us live to make all free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
And now let us bow our heads for God's blessing. Go out this week in the assurance of God's grace, of God's love, of God's mercy. Go out knowing that that truth of what we just sang about is going to refine the world and make all right again. So live in hope and gather again to know your Christ and your Lord. Receive this blessing in the name of God, who is creator of all that is seen and unseen. In the name of Jesus Christ, who is the living word and wisdom of God. And in the name of the Holy Spirit, God's eternal power and presence, who for us is our eternal advocate and friend. And all of God's people said, Amen.
Amen.